Hello and welcome. Happy Friday to everyone. So my name is Mr. Seagull. So when you say good morning to me, good morning, Mr. Seagull. Come on, you can do better than that. One, two, three. Good morning, Mr. Seagull. Thank you, I think that was better. So, my name is Mr. Seagull, or Bobby, you can call me that. I'm a school maths teacher. I'm the author of a book called The Life-Changing Magic of Numbers, which you can see here. And it's all about how maths and numbers have changed my life. And I want to show you how, with the right mindset, maths can help you change your life as well. I'm also the presenter of the BBC TV series Monkman and Seagull's Genius Guide, where me and a friend from Universe Challenge drive around the UK looking at amazing sites of scientific history. And actually, a bit of good news for you. On Monday the 18th of May, on BBC Two at 9 o'clock, our second series begins. So make sure, get your pen and paper out. Monday, 18th May, 9 p.m, BBC Two. Check it out. Mr. Seagull has his second TV series starting, 3 1-hour episodes. You're in for a treat. So, some of you usually in the mornings might have been doing some pee with Joe Wicks, doing some mummy kicks, knee raises, star jumps, and your bodies are active. Now, it's time for you to get your mind active with mathematics. So I'm here with Explore Learning and Explore at Home. And we're here to support education and learning, essentially through these difficult times. And our motto is to keep education going. And you can find more information on how to book a free trial at explorelearning.co.uk. So, we're in the modern world, and we love technology. We love social media. So during these lessons, if you enjoy something, part of the lesson, or you want to take a photograph of your son, daughter, or child in the lesson enjoying themselves, or a video, please feel free to get involved with social media. So the hashtag is #MathsWithBobby. And Explore Learning are Explore Tutors on Twitter and Explore Learning _official on Instagram. And myself, you can message me on Twitter at Bobby_Seagull, or I'm Instagram at Bobby_Seagull, tag me in your stories, or at Bobby_Seagull on TikTok, doing fun maths content. And if you're watching here on Facebook, facebook.com/BobbySeagull. You can find me there, like my page, and find out lots of math stuff. Or if you're on YouTube, find my YouTube channel, Bobby Seagull YouTube. And again, lots of great math content. So I think I'm feeling ready to move on with the lesson. And for those of you who've been here before, you know exactly what I do early on in lessons before we get kicked off. It's our maths mantra, or our maths little rap. And the way it works is, people often come to my lessons and go, "Oh, Mr. Seagull, I can't do maths. It's not meant for me." And they'll come with this sort of cross and say, maths is not for them. But what I tell them is, we can transform that cross into a yes. So this is the way it goes. It goes, 1, 2, 3, go. Yes, I can do maths. Yes, I can do maths. Yes, I can do maths. Let's do that again, so you can see the why. 1, 2, 3, go. Yes, I can do maths. Yes, I can do maths. Yes, I can do maths. There you go. We're going to come back to that at the end. So this is key stage 3. We're here for learners aged 11 to 14. If you're feeling confident and younger, you can still join us. And this week is all about patterns and sequences. And with key stage 2, we looked at something called Fibonacci sequence. And if you go to the Key Stage 2 video, that's really interesting and something that may help you with your understanding later on today. So have a look at the Key Stage 2 video. It's got some fantastic content. So how do my classes work? We usually have about 30 minutes of a lesson. And then I spend a couple of minutes on thoughts of Mr. Seagull, positive ideas and how you can make your, not just maths more positive, but your science, English, even your everyday life, more positive experience. And then usually I take a few questions from parents or carers about how best to support their children. But I think that's enough talking now. I think it's time to get on with the lesson. Are you excited for some maths? Come on, you can do better than that. Are you excited? Let's get going. Let's get the clacker board. It's time for some maths mission magic. There we go. Let's make a start. So today we are looking at patterns and sequences. I'm going to move this out of the way. So when people talk about patterns and sequences, I'm still here. I'm not running away. Just move the board away. Just move it away. Like let's look at a simple sequence. So imagine we had 2, 4, 6, 8. You can probably work out the pattern there. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. And then 12. So these are really basic part of your 2 times table. But how about if I went 20, then 15, then 10? What will be after that? You're going to say 5, isn't it? 20, 15, 10, 5. And this is almost like in the 5 times table, but going backwards, going down by 5. So these are a type of sequence we're going to look at. If I get my chalk, this one on the board here, very similar. So it goes 5, then 9, then 13, then 17. What's after that? What do you think is after that? We should be able to get this. So it's going up by 4. Then it's going up by 4 again. This looks familiar. Then it's going up by 4 again. So what makes logical sense is it goes up by 4 again. 17 plus 4 is 21. So this sequence is going up by 4 every single time. Let's look at another sequence that's similar. So how about we start at 2, then go to 5, then go to 8, then go to 11. And you might be thinking, hey, Mr. Seagull, I can do that. That's easy. Well, so what is it? It's going up by 3. Then it's going up by 3 again. This looks familiar. We know what's going to happen here. And it's going up by 3 again. So the next term would be add 3 to that. 14. We're going up by 3 again. So what you notice about these sequences, what's similar between them and what's different? Have a think. So what's similar between these two? So often I hold a little brain, some brain of mine, some model of my brain. Have a look. I'm going to hold on to this brain. I want you to tell me what's similar between these two sequences and what's different. Have a little think. You got time to think? Okay. So what's similar is that both of them are going up. We agree with that. But there's a few differences. They start at different places. One starts at 5, one starts at 2. And the other one is going up by 4 each time compared to 3 each time. What's going on here? There's actually a word for this type of sequence. And this sequence is called a linear sequence. Linear. Because the amount it's going up by each time stays the same. This is going up by 4s each time, and that's going up by threes. So it's a linear amount. It's the same. There's actually another word we can use. It's called arithmetic. Same thing. Arithmetic. So it's called a synonym. Two words that mean the same thing. So it can be an arithmetic sequence or a linear sequence going up by the same amount each time. So this one here, let's go back to the top sequence. So it goes 5, then 9, then 13, then 17, then 21. Except for that ding-a-ding-a dance here. 5, 9, 13, 17, 21. What's after that? It's 25. After that, 29. After that, 33. So you can keep going. But imagine I said, that's the first term. That's the second term. So they're called terms. That's the third term. That's the fourth term. That's the fifth term. How would you work out the 10th term? You could go in your mind and go 25, 29, 33. But that takes time. And mathematicians, we like to find efficiency, shortcuts to make our life easier. So let's have a look at a way of making this easier. So let's say it's going up in fours each time. This one is going up in fours. What else goes up in fours that we know from primary school? From year one, year two, year three? It's your four times table. 4, 8, 12. And actually, we can write the four times table as this. 4n. And that just means the four times table. N is the first term. So for the first term, you do 4 times 1, 4. For the second term, we do 4 times 2, which is 8 in the times table. And the third term, you say 4 times 3, which is 12. But this isn't quite the 4 times table, is it? Because the 4 times table does 4, 8, 12. This is very similar. It's the 4 times table, but you need to add 1. The 4 times table, but we have to add 1. So we've just found a way of expressing this sequence with a formula. 4n plus 1. So we can test it. Mathematicians, we create an idea and we test it. So for this particular one, that's the first, second, third, fourth, fifth term in the sequence. So we do 4 multiplied by 5, which is 20, then plus the 1, 21. It works. So do you remember the question I asked earlier? What would the 10th term be? Do you know what we could do? 5, 9, 13, count all the way up. But a quicker way is apply this new formula. 4 times 10 is 40, plus the 1 is 41. So there we have 41 is the 10th term. How about you try something for me? Why don't you create an expression to work out the nth term for this. An expression to work out the nth term. And firstly, think about what times table it is. It's going up in threes, that's right. Threes, that's the 3 times table. But it's not quite the 3 times table because the 3 times table goes 3, 6, 9, 12, 15. So it's the 3 times table, but it's 1 less than it. So it's a 3 times table, 3n, but it's 1 less. 3n minus 1. So these are called linear sequences. Linear. So you're still with me. Linear sequence. Let's see if we can make things a bit spicier. Because in maths, when we feel confident, we then raise the game, move on to the next level. So let's have a think. So imagine I gave you a sequence and said, 2, 4. Where do you think it's going next? 2, 4. Where do you think it's going? I think most of you, not all of you, but most of you might say, oh, it's a seagull. That's going to be 6. And to be honest, that's a fair guess. 2, 4. But I'm telling you, it's going to 8. Where do you think it's heading after this? 2, 4, 8. Where do you think it's heading? 16. Do you have a clue where this is heading off? 2, 4, 8, 16. What's next? 32. I think you can see the pattern now. It's doubling each time. 2, 4, 8, 16, 32. And the next one would be 64. And we double that again. We get 1, 2, 8. Let's have a look at another type of sequence. How about we start on 10,000. It's a big number. 10,000. And then let's say the next one is, let's call it 1,000. You're going, what's going on here? Then after 1,000, it's just 100. Then after that, it's just 10. What's going on here? Some of you might look at it and go, oh, Mr. Seagull, it looks like you're just getting rid of a zero. But be careful with your language. We're dividing by 10 each time. Divided by 10. 10,000 divided by 10 gives us 1,000. Then 1,000 divided by 10 gives us 100. Then 100 divided by 10 gives us 10. And then 10 divided by 10 gives us 1. And if you wanted to, you could carry on. 1 divided by 10 is 1 over 10, or 0.1. And you can keep going along. So, again, I'm going to ask you a question. What's similar and different between these two different sequences? What's similar and different? Any ideas? Okay, you're thinking differently. They start off with different numbers. That's fine. And you're thinking, oh, this one's getting larger. That one's getting smaller. But why is that? Because in this particular one, the first sequence, we're multiplying by 2 every single time. Doubling it, doubling it, doubling it. Whereas this one, we're dividing it by 10. Getting smaller each and every time. What's going on? There's actually a mathematical term for this. So do you remember the early one? What was it called? It was called a linear, where we're adding or subtracting the same amount. Linear or arithmetic. But this is called, I can get it on here, a geometric sequence. And this is because we're multiplying or dividing by the same amount each time. Here we multiply by 2, here we divide it by 10. And that number, the 2, or the 10, is called a common ratio. And that's how much, again, this is moving at quite a pace. You can pause it to have a think. It's called a common ratio. How much are you multiplying or dividing by each time? Okay? So, I'm going to set you a little challenge. So imagine I'm very generous, because I can be a generous person. I offer you, let's say, I'm going to give you £1 million. £1 million. You're like, give me the money, give me the million. Or I can offer you a different deal. Let's have a look. You have to tell me whether you accept this deal or no deal. And some of your parents, adults, carers would have heard of a show with a man called Noel Edmonds called Deal or No Deal. Ask them what it was about. And this is our version today. So, welcome to Deal or No Deal with Mr. Bobby Noel Edmonds Seagull. And it's time for Deal or No Deal. So your deal is either you can take 1 million. I need to write that more neatly. This is a bit of an error on the board. You can take £1 million today. You can take that home. It's yours for the keeping. Or you can gamble and do something else. I'll give you 1p. I'm going to double that the next day in total. So you have 2p. And on the third day, I'll say, actually, I'm going to double all what you have to 4p. I'm going to double it again to 8p. I'm going to do that for 30 days. So what are you going to pick for me? Do you want your £1 million or do you want this amount that gets doubled every day? What do you want? Make a decision. I want you to make a decision. Come on. So you're going to take £1 million or you're going to go for this option. I'm going to give you 5 seconds to decide. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Time's up. Time to make your mind up. So what did you pick? Did you go for the million or did you say, I want the 1p doubled every single time for 30 days? So, I'll be honest. When I was at school, when I first saw this problem, I would have said, give me the million. Give me the million. Let me spend it on lots of Pokemon and stickers and sweets. No, lots of broccoli. But actually, let's have a look at this one here. So this one here looks similar to something we've seen very recently. So do you remember recently we had the pattern that went 2, then 4, then 8, then 16, then 32. And that was called a geometric sequence because each time we multiplied by 2. And you know that number 2, the word was called a common ratio. We're multiplying by 2 each time. And I tell you what, this is a bit of maths. It's a bit more advanced than what we do at Key Stage 3. But I'm going to show it to you because I trust you. This is essentially 2 by itself. This is 2 times 2. This is 2 times 2 times 2. And that one is 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, 16. So this one, when you talk about twos, and earlier on, a few weeks ago, we did powers and exponents. Remember we did this? That's called the base, and that's called the exponent of the power. So that was done in one of our earlier videos. So if we said 2 to the power of 1, that means 2 by itself. 2 to the power of 2 is 2 times 2. And 2 to the power of 3 is 2 times 2 times 2. But one thing slightly different, that first term still is there, the 1p. So if you put a minus 1 there, I'll tell you why this works. This is the second term of the sequence. So you do 2 minus 1, which is 1. 2 to the power of 1 is 2. Then for the third term, 2 to the power of 3 minus 1, that's 2 to the power of 2, is 2 times 2, which is 4, which is this. And then this one here is the fourth term. 2 to the power of 4 minus 1, that's 2 to the 3, that's 2 times 2 times 2, which is 8. One bit of homework for you. This would be the first term. So 2 to the 1 minus 1. 2 to the power of 0, according to this, is 1. Can you find out for me? Maybe send me a tweet. It's not very clear. 2 to the power of 0. A tweet in @Bobby_Seagull. Or an Instagram story. Or Explore Tutors. Tell us why 2 to the power of 0 is 1. So this is a bit of research for you to do. But what this tells you is, on the 30th day, this is how much you earn altogether. 2 to the 30 minus 1, and that means 2 to the 29. So that's 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, 29 times. And this is where you're going to be astonished. What did you accept, the £1 million or this deal here? So for those of you who accepted this deal, you might be a bit smug. This is how much you will have at the end of 30 days. You will have 10,737,418.23. 10 times more, nearly 11 times more. So if you went for the second option, you're in the money. You're in the money. And maths has helped you make that. And this shows you how quickly things can grow on the geometric sequence where you're multiplying by the same number each time. And it starts off very small, at 1p, then 2p. But eventually, after 30 days, it overtakes the 1 million. So there you have. There's Mr. Bobby Noledman Seagulls. Deal or no deal. And hopefully, you've taken the deal that gives you 1p, 2p, 4p, 8p, and doubling on and on. So, this is sequences in the mathematical world. But I want to take you on a little journey for the end of this lesson into a world that's very different. We're going to go to the art, and maybe even, if we have time, the music world. We're going to see, actually, mathematical patterns exist there as well. So, let me clean my board first, because mathematicians, we need to be tidy. I like tidiness. And students normally, they're very tidy, neat exercise books. I might give them a sticker. So if you're very neat and tidy if you're working, imagine Mr. Seagull is giving you a virtual sticker, a virtual high five. So I wanted to show you something now. Let's hope this works really smoothly. So, if you want to find out about something called the Fibonacci sequence, have a watch of the key stage 2 video for patterns and sequences. And we look at something that goes like this. 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13. And this is where, it's quite tricky to see from there, but 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, 34. So what you see on the actual screen there, that pattern. And Fibonacci, we're adding the two previous numbers to make the next one. And you can spend more time with this by looking at our key stage 2 video. But the reason I bought this is, we can see patterns and sequences in the natural world. On that diagram that you see in front of you, there's, I think, a sunflower. There's a floret of broccoli. There's a nautilus seashell. There's the galaxy. There's a thunderstorm. There's DNA sequencing. And we see the Fibonacci sequence occur there. But what I wanted to do was bring you to one of my favorite artists and show you how actually sometimes people in the creative world use patterns and sequences and mathematical ideas. So this is an artist called M.C. Escher. M.C. Escher. So I'm going to read you a bit from my book. So it's called The Life-Changing Magic of Numbers, about how numbers change my life. And I go through my life in terms of sport, music, art, cooking, my first job, and how maths really helped me. So in this particular chapter, so I'm on page, so there's two versions of the book. There's a hardcover and a paperback. So in the hardcover, have a look there. So I said, two works in particular demonstrate how M.C. Escher, the artist, intertwined maths and art in this magnetic form. So what you see in front of you, the House of Stairs, actually appears impossible to construct in real life. But it has two vanishing points, and it made parallel lines run towards them and abound in a curved manner. Because if you look at that, you can't possibly construct that. And there's a film that your parents or carers may have watched called Labyrinth with David Bowie. And in this film, I think made in the late 80s, they have stairs like this that are impossible to make, but mathematically you can create it on a piece of paper. But in the real world, you couldn't recreate that. Let's have a look at another pattern he's created. So, on this one here, it's called Circle Limit 4. So what I said here is, the top of this, it's called a lithograph, is a repetition of the bottom. So the scene could carry on forever. And that was the one with the stairs. That's the staircase scene could carry on forever. But in this particular work that you see now, with the bats, they look like bats, but actually they're angels and demons. And it forms sort of a tessellating, repeating pattern. And the spaces between one cleverly form the actual shape of another. And again, if you look at it, it has a mathematical feel to it. Then we move on to this, circle limit number three. And this is very similar as well. And this is amazing. This piece of art introduces you to a topic that students at A level and university study called hyperbolic geometry. It's crazy, but mathematics can be seen in art. And artists sometimes love to show off that they understand basic bits of mathematics. I wanted to show you one artist in particular. So this man is called Jackson Pollock. I've got more about it in my book as well, Jackson Pollock. So Jackson Pollock created art. And if you look at that, you're thinking, Mr. Siegel, that looks like a year one student did that. They just scattered paint. What is it? And in fact, he did more works like this. An American artist in the 20th century. More work, just looks like scattered paint. But this is a homework task for you. I want you to try and research for me how Jackson Pollock used maths to create these works of art. So your homework is, how did Jackson Pollock use maths to create these works of art? And I'm telling you, the answer is in my book, but if you look it on the internet, you'll find it there as well. And I want you to submit your ideas to @Bobby_Siegel on Twitter or Instagram, or go onto Facebook, so facebook.com/Bobby Siegel, and send me your ideas. And obviously, please tag in @ExploreTutors as well. So I want you to tell me, how does Jackson Pollock use mathematics to create the patterns on his work? So, we're going to conclude the lesson by looking at something else, music. So we're going to play a piece, and hopefully the sound will work. We're going to play a piece. So have a listen here. Have a listen for me. So hopefully the sound should work. Keep that playing for a bit. So this, to be honest, feels a bit disturbing. So this is a piece called the Quartet for the End of Time. So my writing might be a bit small. Quartet for End of Time. And it was by a musician called Olivier Messiaen. And he was a prisoner of war during World War II. And while he was a prisoner of war, he tried to create some music that felt slightly disturbing, but you can hear it. And I'll tell you something about this. There are two parts of the music. He had a rhythm sequence that kept on repeating, and a harmonic sequence that kept on repeating. And here, the rhythm sequence repeated every 17 notes, so the rhythm sequence, and the harmonic sequence repeated every 29 notes. And you might be thinking, Mr. Siegel, what's special about those numbers? 17 and 29, they belong to another type of mathematical sequence. If I said to you 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13, 17, 19, 23, 29, these are prime numbers. So Messiaen actually used prime numbers in his work, his music, the one that you're hearing now. And the reason for that is the rhythm only repeats every 17 notes, and the harmonic side only repeats every 29 chords, which means, if you think about lowest common multiple, they only overlap after 493. If you multiply together, you have 493. And this is an example of a mathematician brain. A mathematician's brain being applied to music. So he has a prime number, another prime number, and they're two different bits, the rhythm and the harmonic, and they only overlap every 493. Have a think about that. That's amazing. A musician using a mathematical sequence to make it feel a bit unsettling. Because normally in music, things sort of overlap. But here they don't till 493 sections. That is quite powerful. So, we've come to the end of the main part of the lesson. We've got about 5-10 minutes to go. And what I want to do is, I want to share with you thoughts of Mr. Seagal, positive ideas. But before that, I wanted to show you something that's related to this. So I'm going to go back to my PowerPoint. So, I had my brain scanned for a BBC documentary called The Great British Intelligence Test. And for this, they wanted to understand, you know, but we know Bobby's smart. Is there something about his brain that makes him smarter? And actually, what they found out was, my brain is smaller than average. How? Bobby seems to be smart, and yet his brain is smaller. If you go to BBC iPlayer and look this up, Horizon, Great British Intelligence Test, you can find it and watch it over the weekend and let me know what you think. But this is what I think the key point is. It's not necessarily about your brain and what's there, because your brain is your brain. What's much more important is your attitude to learning. Are you someone that thinks I can get better at things? Or are you someone that thinks, oh, I just, you know, I can't do maths. I can't do cooking. I can't do dancing. It's your mindset that makes you a good mathematician, a good cooker, a good dancer. Okay, you might not become the best in the world, but wherever you are, you can get a lot better if you have a mindset that says, actually, I'm going to put in hard work into this. And sometimes, some of the topics we've covered today, you might be thinking, oh, Mr. Seagal, you went a little bit too quickly. That's okay. Go back, review it. Maybe use Google. Maybe use Explore Learning website. Practice the work. And I think the key thing is your mindset and attitude are what helps you to progress in mathematics. So that is Mr. Seagal's thoughts today. My thought essentially is, don't put limitations on yourself. Don't put limitations. Because if you do that, then others in society will say, oh yes, we know James isn't very good at maths. Oh, no, we know Lisa isn't good at English. No, don't put limits on yourself. Work hard, put in the effort, get support from your teachers, your friends, your family. But the key thing is, always think you're more capable. Because we're not defined by what we're born with. Actually, what makes who we are is how we decide to act upon our skills and talents. And that's the most important thing. Things that you can make an impact. I can choose to work hard at school. I can choose to practice my running. I can choose to work on my singing. And they're the things that you can make an impact on. So have that growth mindset. Thank you. So that is thoughts of Mr. Seagal. So I had a couple of questions. What I'm going to do is, I had a couple of questions from parents before we go to our maths wrap. A couple of questions from parents. So before that, I wanted to say that if you enjoy my positive mental ideas, can you go to YouTube and look up Bobby Seagal TED Talk? So I have a talk called Maths. It's all about maths and how maths is magic. Maths is magic. So if you look this up, Bobby Seagal, TED Talk, about maths is magic. It shows you how I think all of us can be mathematicians. And the talk is 4 squared minutes long, 16 minutes. It's really positive, really upbeat, like I am. Watch it and let me know what you think. It's only 16 minutes, but 16 minutes of fun and maths joy. And if you really enjoy watching me here at Explore Learning, watch this talk and let me know what you think. So that is my maths TED talk. So let's see a couple of questions from parents. So the first one was, How do I know what topics my child is studying at school? So it's a good question. So there is a national curriculum, topics that people study, whether in year 4, year 5, year 6, year 7, year 8, year 9, so on. But every school has their own website. And on the website, it should normally tell you the specific parts of the curriculum people are following each term, and even each sub-half term. So go to the school website and check it out for maths. And obviously, you can always ask the teacher. And again, if you're in secondary school, consult your form teacher or the maths teacher. And I'm sure they'll be willing to tell you what curriculum they're following. Okay, and a second question here. How can my child's maths help them in other subjects? Again, another great question. So how can my child's maths help with other subjects? And for this, the answer is, in maths, we learn skills like how to plot graphs, how to interpret data, how to be logical. And actually, these skills are used in other subjects, some in particular. So in science, when you plot graphs about dependent and independent variable, that is mathematics. Or in geography, if you're comparing population sizes using, let's say, a pie chart, that is mathematics. Or even in English, you're trying to work out, you need to get through a particular book that's 500 pages and you've got 20 days. How many pages do you need to read a day? 500 divided by 20, I think that's 25. Again, mathematics. So maths can actually help you in lots of different areas. Food technology, PE, science. But it's always trying to think, I've learned something in maths. Can I apply it to another area? So maths actually can help with the whole range of a school curriculum. Okay, so I'm going to bring back this board here. Bring back this board. So do you remember? Let's not spill anything. So we'd love you to share your ideas, your posters, your thoughts, images of the lesson. So the hashtag is MathsWithBobby and ExploreTutors on Twitter and ExploreLearning_official. And I'm at Bobby_Seagull. Let's move back to the main thing. I'm Bobby_Seagull on Twitter, on Instagram and TikTok. And if you're trying to find me on Facebook, which you probably can do quite easily, go to facebook.com/BobbySeagull and do give me a little like there, and then you'll hopefully find out more about mathematical activities going on. And then on YouTube, I have a channel called Bobby Seagull, YouTube channel, and you can find my TED Talk linked in there as well, or you can Google that. So if you need further support, please head over to explorelearning.co.uk. And you can book a free online trial. And there are plenty of resources there that it can help you consolidate the learning from today's class. So before we conclude and end with our positive wrap, I wanted to say something that I'm doing this weekend and every other weekend. So I do something called Quiz for NHS. It's hosted on my YouTube channel. So this Saturday at 5 o'clock, join me on my YouTube channel, and we have a quiz that has a primary school round with some maths questions, has some charades where I act out, and you know I like my acting. It has a music round, a pictures round, and it's real great family fun from young kids who are 4 or 5 to grandparents who are 75. All of us can take part. So if you look up justgiving.com/quizforNHS, or just head over to my Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, Facebook, you'll find lots of information there. But I'd love some of the Explore learners who are fearless to come and join me on Saturday. So, I think it's time for our conclusion. Time for our conclusion. So, we know when people come to my lesson, sometimes they'll say, Mr. Seagull, I can't do maths. But we can change that, can't we? Because we know that it's your mindset, your heart, that makes a difference. So what we tell them is, yes, I can do maths. Yes, I can do maths. Yes, I can do maths. Come, let's do it 2 more times. 1, 2, 3, go. Yes, I can do maths. Yes, I can do maths. Yes, I can do maths. Last time. 3, 2, 1, go. Yes, I can do maths. Yes, I can do maths. Yes, I can do maths. It turns into a Y. Thank you.